Fiqh is actually a very important part of our deen. Jurisprudence. Many of you may, well, all of you have heard of fiqh. It's part and parcel of our life. Asasun fi deen. There is no movement in our life without fiqh. Fiqh, the laws, the rules, the injunctions of sharia. A human being, man, woman, cannot move without the laws and ahkam of sharia. It relates to every part of our life. Every part, every second, every moment of our life is connected to fiqh. And this fiqh is the understanding of the Quran and Sunnah. It's not something which is besides the Quran and Sunnah. Fiqh is the understanding of the Quran and Sunnah. Basically, fiqh, literally, linguistically, fiqh means to understand. In Arabic, you have faqiha yafqahu, which means to understand. And the one who has this understanding, well, actually in the Arabic language, from the linguistic point of view, you have two sort of words, faqiha yafqahu, and you have faquha yafquhu. There's actually a difference. One is faqiha, which means to have some sort of understanding, basic understanding. Every human being has this faqiha yafqahu, basic understanding of whatever, you know, they have understanding. So if somebody has a basic understanding of something, that is known as faqiha yafqahu, and the one who has that understanding is known as faqih. And then there is another, from the same root word, you have faquha yafquhu, which means someone who has a real deep understanding. And the one who has this deep understanding is known as faqih. And faqih is a jurist. The plural is fuqaha. We've had fuqaha from the time. Well, the first faqih was who? Who was the first faqih? Sayyidul fuqaha. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who better understood the Quran and his own statements than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the first faqih of this ummah, the Sayyidul Fuqaha. Because fiqh basically means to go deep, to understand the Quran and Sunnah is basically what fiqh is. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the first faqih. But this is not for everyone. That's why when we see the companions, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, how many companions were there? Hundreds and thousands of Sahaba. But from them, as Imam Ibn al-Qayyim puts it, between 120 to 150 fuqaha Sahaba, that's it. Nobody else. Out of the thousands of Sahaba companions. How many? Most of them, and many of them were relating hadith. They were relating hadith, they were muhaddithun, they were relating hadith, narrators of hadith. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu was known as the most prolific narrator of hadith. Many of them were relating hadith. But when it came to understanding, going deep into the aspects of the hadith, whether there's, how do you sort of reconcile between contradictory narrations? Is this nasikh? Is this mansukh? Is this the abrogating hadith? Has this been abrogated? What is the deeper meaning of this? What is the literal meaning of this? What is the deeper meaning of this? How do you reconcile between different types of narrations? How do you reconcile between some hadith and Quran? This is all to do with fiqh. So there were only between 120 to 150 sahaba who were known to be the fuqaha. They were deriving laws, they were extracting laws from the Quran and Sunnah. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith of Musnad Ahmad, Tirmidhi and elsewhere, he mentioned the virtues of the fuqaha. Remember, those who are not fuqaha, there's also virtues for those kind of sahaba companions, as well as the later tabi'un and muhadithun, the ones who are just narrating. But specifically for the fuqaha, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأً سَمِعَ مِنَّا حَدِيثًا فَحَفِظَهُ وَبَلَّغَهُ غَيْرَهُ فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam used the word فِقْهٍ. فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهٍ. Allah illuminate the person, meaning his face, his heart. Allah illuminate. This is a dua from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah illuminate the man who hears a hadith from me, and then he memorizes it, and then he relates it to somebody else. This actually is a dua for the narrator of hadith, the one who just hears it and then relates it to somebody else. And then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهِ. The one sometimes who's relating is actually not a faqih. He just relates the hadith. And in another riwayah, he said, فَرُبَّ مُبَلَّغٍ أَوْعَى مِنْ سَامِعٍ. Sometimes the one to whom he relates the hadith to is more understanding of the hadith itself. So there's many virtues. There's a hadith as well in Sahih al-Bukhari. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. With whomever Allah intends good, Allah gives them him a deep fiqh understanding. مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. So there's numerous narrations. And as I said, this is not for everybody, because fiqh is very specific. It requires a lot of intelligence, a lot of deep understanding. It requires a lot of effort as well, a lot of time. You know, not a lot of people have time. Fiqh is only for people who have time, who can take up time, seriously. Yes, if you've got a wife who's going to complain, then you can never be a faqih for the brothers. Because you can't. You need a wife who will sacrifice everything, your day and night. Ask the people who are involved in fiqh. They have phone calls coming at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock sometimes. You have to answer 100, 200 questions per week. I'm not saying month. 100, 200 questions per week. Seriously. So this is not for everybody. This fiqh is very it requires a lot of effort.